And now for a very happy moment, maybe my most happy moment so far at the Montreal World Film Festival. We are here with one of France's greatest stars, Marie Gillain.
Yes.
Gillain. I got the name wrong. Okay. It's Gillain.
Gillain. It's very hard
Gillain.
For American people. Gillain.
Gillain.
Marie Gillain.
Gillain.
Yes.
Okay, exactly. Okay. And the director, Francois-Xavier Vives.
Exactly.
Vive la France. Vive votre film, which I saw this morning, as you know. Because these kind of people, we were at this wonderful dinner, which actually we didn't like because it was so slow. The service was so slow. And then we had breakfast, too. So we had two meals together.
That's how we got along.
That's how well we got along, and a cab ride and everything. So I thought I had to have them on the show. And then I saw your wonderful film. And I got up early, as you did, to see it.
Very brave.
Yeah.
Yes, it was.
So courageous.
Yes. And the name of the film is?
It's Londres. It's a French,
that's
French title. It's
Londres. Because like, that's also the word for London, isn't it? It sounds like.
Not London. Londres, like land. Like the land. But we have an English title, which is Under the Pines.
Enter the Pines?
Under the Pines. Yeah, Under the Pines.
Okay.
Because the action takes place under a huge forest in the southwest of France.
Which is where you're from.
Yeah.
So it had all this authenticity about the struggles of the people there. And is this a true story, mademoiselle?
Yeah, kind of. It's Francois knows very well this area because he was born there, and it's the story of her aunt, in a way.
Your aunt?
Yéna Duprat. She really existed.
Great aunt or something like this in my family. At the point of origin of this project is this real woman, this real Yéna Duprat, which is her name in the film. And actually,
it was her real name.
And in the early 20s, in the southwest of France, she lived there, and she was a young widow, and she decided to rent the big estates of her husband, and she had to make her accepted and respected by the landowners there
and the workers,
and in a very difficult and complex context, because there was a social struggle that was going on at that time, and so the film is telling her story in a way.
Well, we don't want to give away what happens in it, because it gets more and more and more dramatic as it goes on. But mademoiselle, that's a performance. I didn't say performance in French, but performance.
I'm very happy that you told the story, because I was like, okay, if he asked me to tell the story of the movie, I would be very embarrassed.
Well, let's just...
But he did it very well.
Well, it was beautifully done, and as it gets towards the climax of the film, I mean, there were some very, very emotional scenes that I got very moved by.
Oh yeah?
Yeah, she's a very strong woman, and at the same time, of course, vulnerable. And
I don't want to say what happens, but you know what I'm talking about, and the viewers will just have to wait to see. I'm going to mispronounce the title of the film. It sounds like London, but it's Londa. So I'm learning French on the air.
Like land and freedom.
Land and freedom. There we go. Land. And all these things start happening to her that are just catastrophic, you know.
But it's like if she, how do you say, she bones? She bones again? No. It's a new life for her.
Oh, she's reborn, yeah.
Yeah, her husband died. And she decides to manage everything on her own. And she will, of course, fight against the men around her, because at this time, women were just like women.
Yeah.
In the tea room.
Right.
But not,
right.
You know, at the head of
a large enterprise like that.
Factory.
Yeah.
So she will be alone in this fight. And also, it's a very sensitive the way we discover the forest, because the nature, the power of the nature, is very present in the movie.
Yes. It was terrific. It was really unexpected, and it I learned things about France, you know, that I never knew before, like all these true events of this true story happening, and the workers uprising and challenging you very violently, and you know, all of that was
it's a romantic tale. It's some kind of romantic tale with
war and peace, sort of.
Yeah, with something about modernity. What is the true modernity? Is it technology, or is it more social? Maybe something.
Yes, because she wants to bring. What's interesting is she wants to bring electricity.
That's her husband's dream.
Uh-huh. So,
they are a very original couple together.
Uh-huh.
In this dark country, stuck to privileges and old-fashioned life manners. And together with her husband, they travel, they are very open-minded. And he has this foolish dream of bringing electricity on everywhere around his estates and farms and so on.
And there's that wonderful scene in the peasant's house where you get the electricity turned on and they have the light bulb and they're like, what? What do we need this for? We've got candle light.
Yes.
Oh, they're like,
she doesn't understand why they don't use the electricity. You know, she's a little bit, and she goes in during the night, she goes to their house and they say, yeah, we have electricity. And so they turn on the light but it's not, it doesn't use to them. You know, just to light their misery.
They're frightened.
At that time, it's pointless.
And they kept looking. There was sort of this refrain of looking at all these pictures of New York in the 20s. And I'm just, having just left New York, I'm going, oh no, New York again? You know, I just got out of there. We're here in Montreal, and you just arrived, and you're jet lagged. I mean, from Paris, I guess. And
I feel all right.
You feel all right?
In the movie, you know, this skyline of Manhattan
is beautiful.
It's the myth for modernity.
And yes.
From the south part of France, from there, they dream about that, and they dream to modernity and to modern times, saying or dreaming that there is some kind of a electric city that never sleeps. You know,
well, it's true. I live in Times Square, and the noise is making me deaf. But anyway,
but in the 20s,
in the 20s, maybe it wouldn't have been so bad. But anyway, now it's just like, oh my God, it just doesn't stop. The city never sleeps. I wish it would.
So you see it's true then.
yes. And
from the point of view of someone who was living in the, deep in the forest of the South France at that time,
it's
a real different planet.
Yes. Yeah,
that's why he's dreaming about that.
Yes, sure. I mean it's the greatest city in the world. What can I say?
But Paris, this dream
of course,
is pointless for the people there, for the farmers and
right.
so on.
So you haven't had much to see of Montreal so far. You just sort of here and at the restaurant last night with Serge.
Yeah. And the press conference.
The press conference is coming
tomorrow.
Up.
Yeah. No. In a few moments.
A few minutes. We'll make sure you get out of there, but just barely. I don't want you to ever leave.